Good evening. Welcome to the November 9th, 2016 Deerfield Selectboard and Board of Health meeting here in the Town Hall. First item on the agenda is the minutes of the 26th and November 1st, 2016. Have you had a chance to read them?
I've read them. And okay. I make a motion that we accept the minutes as written.
And I second that. Is there any further discussion?
No.
Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. The Stillwater Bridge, Kevin is working on that diligently, and we're hoping that it will be open sooner than later. I just want to mention that flu shots are available on Wednesdays from the 10 o'clock to 2 p.m. here in our town nurse's office. And we have a hearing at 6:45 on the sewer. So we are a little early for that. The cable license is, we're going to table that tonight, Kip. There's some last minute changes on the, we needed on the, but it should be ready to sign for next week.
Okay.
And the only other item that we, oh no, we have two items, but we have to wait for Trevor on the third one. The next item on the agenda that is voting is to appoint Chief John Pachorik as Emergency Manager Assistant. And I make that motion.
Second it. I was under the impression that he was that already, no?
No. Oh. What happens is when you go on to the web EOC or call MEMA, if you need to have a title, emergency manager title. So this was an oversight. We have Mark Gilmore as our manager and Zach Smith as our assistant manager, but John actually wasn't named, so we're going to name him now. And if there's no further discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Thanks a lot. I'll sign that, and then you can sign that. And so he is now official. Not that that makes any difference. He's always on top of things, but this way he can call in. And then I didn't know if you were able to go to the Franklin County Selectmen's Association meeting on December 8th. We just need to let Pat know so she can RSVP for us.
Where's that at?
In Waitley.
Is that what we, same thing that we went to at Chandler's about a month ago?
Yeah.
Okay. Sure.
Okay. I'll just have to check with Trevor and then let Pat know. No. I guess the only other thing, we have to get Trevor to update us on the IT grant. Were you able to set up a meeting with the New England Bakers? Or have you talked to Dee Dee?
Nope.
Okay.
That's
okay. I can give her a call and make sure she's okay.
I did speak with her. And I told her that Roger and I could get together with her whenever she.
Okay, she just got it back to you. Okay. I just want to make sure she felt like we were paying attention to her so they can make that decision to move on. Okay. Unfortunately, now we have to wait.
Well, if you want, I can talk about this. I read that report about the South County Grammar School. And the first thing that came to mind when I was reading this is, who did this study? And the people who did the study are actually in the business of doing this type of restoration work.
Yep.
So it came to no surprise to me that they recommended that you could rebuild this, but I think the cost of rebuilding it would be quite extensive. And I have spent a lot of time.
We had an estimate, I think, of about $1 million.
Yeah, it's a little better than that. I questioned some of the things that they spoke about in here. One of the things that they talked about was that the floor joists and the thing was very sound and structurally, intact. And that is true. But the problem is at the ends where they rest on the bearing walls is where the rot is started up. And it doesn't matter if the middle's strong if the end's going to fall off. And this has happened in a couple of areas that I could see. So I can only imagine there's other places where water's been leaking in that it could be that way or more. The abatement to their solution to the abatement of all of the mold in the basement is basically that you're going to destroy, when I say destroy, you're going to have to rip apart the entire basement of that, you know, and it's just going to be an ongoing problem. If you go up to the third floor, there's these large, I call them cables, but they're not, they're steel rods, and they're about an inch in diameter that crisscross the building. They're kind of holding it together. And you can see where the wood is kind of fracturing because where the cables are, the rods are, the building is staying intact. But 3 feet in either direction, it's starting to bow.
And that's from the weight of the masonry?
I don't really know. I think that the building is settling internally. The bricks on the outside are staying, but you look at the windowsills and they're kind of pulling in, and I kind of think the wood is just settling down. Some of it could be from rot and decay or old age. I'm not sure. I think if the community thinks that this building is worth saving or replicating, it'd be my recommendation to take a lot of measurements and pictures, tear it down, and build a new one that looks like that. I think you'd spend less money, and then you could do a lot of different things to assure that you don't have water in the basement and that it's, you know, very energy efficient, and you don't have problems going down the road with, you know, something else giving way.
Well, yeah, what building is this?
It's the old grammar school, the senior center.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I thought this was the old grammar
school. Yeah. This is the new one.
This is a new one.
No, well, the old one was in the front.
The old one was
a
1902 building.
Yeah, yeah, that, because it says it was built in 1888.
So, took them 6 years to build it.
Oh, it did. But, you know, that there are a lot of issues in there, and I think that once you dig into it, the issues are just going to escalate. You know? And you're basically going to, even with this report, you're going to be replacing everything in the building anyways, except for the framing and the brickwork. And, I don't know. You know, if people, like I said, if people like that look of that building and they want to keep it, I would still tear it down and just build it back, you know, so it looks the same. You could do the same dimensions, do the same brickwork and everything, you know.
So, well, I...
But that was my take on
it. Yeah, okay. And that was what I needed you to do. We'll wait one more minute. Thank you for doing that. I really appreciate it. I wanted your input on that.
Excuse me, are your speakers working?
I think so. I'm sorry. They're not? Okay, we'll talk louder.
You hear every other word.
Oh, I'm sorry. Well, we're waiting patiently for a little bit closer to, at least my watch is 6:45, and then we can be legitimate.
Could you give us a little more update on Stillwater, other than Kevin's working on it? What is holding it up?
Well, we pulled the permits yesterday. We're waiting for Natural Heritage to give us the go-ahead. You have to verify that there's no turtles or turtle nesting and all that kind of stuff. And the dive team from this DOT is going to is documenting that with our camera. Remember, we bought the sewer camera. Well, it's paid for itself multiple times already in the sewer system, but we're also using the sewer camera to document that there hopefully are no turtle problems anywhere near the Stillwater Bridge for Natural Heritage. So it's saving us a considerable amount of money, and hopefully, I mean, the permit is only good for 30 days, so hopefully this is going to happen within 30 days. Otherwise, we'll have to look for extensions. But the concrete should be okay because the water is, you know, it cures in water, and the water temperature is going to be pretty steady for quite a while. So it should be all right. That's about all we know at this point still. We're sort of, it depends on what the state wants to do and when they want to do it. We're working very hard to make sure that it happens.
So is the state actually going to be doing the work, or is the town doing the work?
No, we're just paying for the materials.
Oh.
It's a state pump truck and the dive team, and everybody's, you know, going to be doing it, not us. Our expense is related to the grout and the additive to the grout and the grout bags. And hopefully we way overestimated it, which, but we haven't, we're not, are we postponed our town meeting anyway, and we got permission to deficit spend. So it really doesn't, at this point, you know, the actual cost of the grout is not, you know, a problem, because we haven't voted them out and then worried about what the actual bill is. We'll just, whatever the actual bill is the one we're going to pay.
So we weren't in on that last round of state grants for fixing any of
the apparently not. Oh, you mean no, we were never, our bridge was never in the, that
pipeline.
That, those were for smaller bridges. This bridge is on the list. I have been vigilant and a witch after the state. They don't even want to talk to me half the time, but we have been on that list and off that list and on that list and off that list. But we have a number, and it is 2021, and they are, or 2020 when they actually put out the plans, and they are doing, it is, money has been allocated to the bridge process. So it will be replaced, and the state is going to pay for it, which is, you know, a relief, because otherwise that is, you know, an $8 to $10 million cost to the town of Deerfield, because it's a town of Deerfield bridge. So it's been worth going to all those meetings. The last meeting we went, Trevor and I went to, we verified the number and everything, and that was in May. And when the DOT guy was here for the informational night for Stillwater, he gave us an actual commitment number. So I, you know, you never know what's going to happen, because it depends on federal funding. So, but potentially it's supposed to be 2020 that the plans will go out to bid and it will start. So it's in the pipeline. And the state will pay for it at this point. I don't know what he alluded that it was a complete replacement because the piers were in such bad shape. But because, as John knows, the original piers that we were diving on, I don't know, what was it, 14 years ago when we when I first was elected, I found out it was our bridge and that it was in bad shape. And I'm like, oh, my God, we're going to have to pay for this. So that was when Blake Gilmore volunteered the state police dive team to do a drill. And they took a picture, and that's how we got it on the original list, because I was the transportation representative on, you know, county representative. And so we got it on the list. And that was, I don't know, John, that was, then we got it on the list for every other year inspection, which was really good, because then it meant it was really in the pipeline. And then it got to be really bad the last couple years. After Irene, it was a North Pier, and so they've been doing the inspection every year. So, but that, I mean, Irene was 5 years ago, believe it or not. So just having it inspected every year for the last 5 years has been significant in itself. So, well, my watch says it's 6:45, so we'll start the sewer information night. And what I'm going to do is turn it over to Kip to answer questions. We really don't have a handout, but as you mentioned earlier, Kathy, we missed this round of Mass Works, from my understanding, because
I just wasn't sure.
Yeah. So that doesn't mean that we're not resubmitting. That's already in the process.
I just learned about that. When did you find that out?
Well, we didn't get the notice that we got any money, so that's when we assumed that we were not picked. They awarded the money. We were not invited to the state house, so that means we weren't picked.
Okay. Seems how it goes.
Yeah. So we have to make light of it. But that's what happened with River Road. We had, you know, we put in for River Road, and then the next year is when we got River Road. And that was $1 million request. So
is it something that we can request again next year?
Excuse me, can you please speak up? We can't hear you.
Oh, I'm sorry. River Road took 2 years of Mass Works to get through. We applied, we put it together, and we applied, and we didn't get it the first year. So the second year, we put in for it, and we did get it. And so I'm assuming that, you know, we'll have a better chance second round because we're consistently asking for it, for help.
So if we're not going to be getting any of this money, has Keith said anything to you about the Headworks project? Or, I mean, you know, we need to address the issue of, you know, the weight, some of the waste that's getting into the plant that's causing a lot of the problems from him. And I had looked into that other screening method that, you know, was not a permanent fix, but, you know, for the cost, it would certainly help the plant run more efficiently. And it was something that could be retrofitted into the series of trenches that we already have. And, you know, it's something that we should look into. Otherwise, the problems that they have are going to continue to get worse. And, you know, we're going to, I don't know how many times they've burned out those motors or whatever, but I looked at the electric cost and, you know, we're spending about $3,800 a month, which kind of goes toward another, you know, problem. Oh, well.
No, he hasn't said anything.
Is there no handout so we can know what the projects are or why our rates are doubled, et cetera? Is the sewer running in the red now? We just have just one letter here which says nothing about anything except the rate increases.
Well, there's a problem. First of all, with the sewage treatment plants, they're running and they're operating fine, but there's problems. You know, it's getting old. There's different components to it that are failing from time to time. And also the infrastructure, the pipes going to the system. And we need to start addressing those issues. There's a committee of seven of us that are studying what should be done or what could be done, where money can come from, and how is the best way to proceed, whether we close one of the sewer treatment plants and run it all to one plant, or that we, you know, repair both plants. Those are things that we're looking at. But in the meantime, we had to set a sewer rate for this coming year, or half of the year, and that's where we came up with the rate that we currently have.
You say there are seven on the
study? Yes. There are seven individuals on the sewer study committee. I'm from the Board of Selectmen, and we're here just to answer the questions about the sewer rate for this year. The sewer rate study committee they're studying this thing, and they're going to have an entire report or some sort of report probably mid-January into February about what direction the town should go in. You know, and a lot of the things has to do with what needs to get done, what kind of funding is available, and things like that. What we're addressing. Yes, because the rates that are happening now are just to offset the cost of what's going on now. There's a good chance that the rates are going to go quite a bit higher than this. And the reason is, if you think about it now, most people are paying about $8 a month for sewer. Or in this day and age, people pay $100 for a cell phone, they pay $150 for TV. But yet every time you flush your toilet, it's costing you $8 a month. It's pretty cheap. Deerfield sewer rates are so cheap that when we apply for grants from different organizations, they almost laugh at us, say, you guys don't need any money. Look what you're doing. You know, your people are not burdened by the cost of this. And half of the reason is that nothing's been done to these things. Well, now we're getting to a point where things have to change, and it's going to be expensive. Yes?
Future expenses that are now suddenly becoming obvious, or should this have been basically, there should just have been systematic 10% increases for the last few years rather than like, oh wow, surprise, we have no money, we're going to have to double your rates. It seems kind of incompetent on the level of the sewer commissioners, I don't know who they are, but not keeping track of this, if this is not an emergency situation, but something that just built up over multiple years due to inaction or, you know, or just ignorance of the whole thing.
Well, I can't really speak because I've only been here for 5 or 6 months, and I would say it's not inaction because of ignorance. It's probably inaction just to keep the rates low. And I don't know if that's accurate.
Well, I mean, John's here too, but one of the things is we had a long-term sewer superintendent, and we thought everything was fine. It wasn't until actually a couple of years ago that when we had to hire a new person that all these problems, we became aware of these problems. And so that, and the reason why it seems like nobody knows what's going on is because, you know, the repairs have been estimated to be up to $30 million. So I attempted to make a HUD grant for $20 million. We didn't get it. We made the first round, but we didn't make the final round. And, you know, the idea was to abandon, it was a resiliency grant, so we were going to abandon the old Deerfield sewer treatment plant that needs approximately $10 million to be repaired, and just connect to Greenfield, have that end of town connect to Greenfield. And then we were going to upgrade, there's about approximately $20 million of repairs in South Deerfield, I mean, if you did everything. And so we were going to connect Sunderland to it and have them abandon their plant and then maybe potentially connect Whately so that you would have enough users to offset some of the upgrades. So, you know, and make sure the rates stayed stable. We did not get that grant. And so we applied, we've had multiple informational meetings about some of the repairs, and it was agreed, this committee, sewer committee came together and said, well, the first thing we have to do is this headworks project. So we applied for the Mass Works project, and the advice that was given to us was that we had to raise the rates, otherwise they would not even look at the application. So that was part of the process, was raising the rates. And obviously any revenue that's generated goes into the pot for repair. However, this is truthfully a drop in the bucket. So what we need to do is keep applying for grants and figure out the priority for repairs and how we're going to move forward. And that is part of the report that Kip is alluding to. It's not that we don't know what to do. We do know what to do, but we're $30 million short, so we're going to figure out. And it's not as disastrous. I mean, it could fail, but and then we'd be subject to fines, and we'd have to do some kind of emergency repairs. But we have time to figure out a path, and the idea is to come up with as being as creative as possible to keep the expenses as low as possible and have a permanent long-term fix that is good for the environment, it's good for the town, and good for the system. John.
I'd like to cover several points with you, if you don't mind.
Not at all.
No, that's fine.
I just happen to have a few handouts for you, just so you won't feel left out. First one is a sanitary sewer policy, which was established back in 2002. The second one is a tax recap sheet for this year. And I'll explain all about these in a couple of minutes. The third one is a list of the top 10 taxpayers. The town of Deerfield should only bring in $1.4 million just for the top 10 people. For 10 groups.
But the thing I want to start with is this rebuild that we're talking about has to be fair to everybody. The first thing I'm bringing up to you is the sanitary sewer policy, which was voted in at town meeting in 2002. And what it basically says is everything that comes into the sewer, stays with the sewer, and you can't charge anybody else in town. there's several fallacies to that policy. First of all, that's like making a policy saying, I don't have any kids in the school, therefore you can't tax me for paying for the schools, which is 3/4 of our taxes. And that is an illogical policy, and usually in a Commonwealth of Massachusetts, everybody shares to make the better good for everybody. The first point I want to make out is the NPDES permit. You have two NPDES permits, National Pollution Discharge Elimination System permits, which I'm sure you're familiar with. It's very clear from that permit that if something happens to the town, anywhere, to one of the town lines underneath the Main Street or South Main Street or Sugarloaf Street or anywhere, the town has that responsibility to repair it. And if anybody gets fined, it's the town that gets fined, not the sewer users.
That's correct, John.
Now, recognizing that, my next point is that we have to repeal this policy because this policy is illogical, and there's no reason why the non-sewer users don't help support that sewer plant, because that plant provides many things. Number one, it provides an economic engine to the town. And if you go to handout number 2 that I gave you, it shows that this is our tax rate for this year, $10,063,681.89. And of that, commercial contribute over $921,000, and industrial contributes another $1.11 million. So we're getting over basically 22%. So out of a $10 million budget that we voted, we're getting over $2 million for industry and commercial use. And the next point that I want to make out is that you have a American Farmland Trust study which was done, which I passed out to this committee. Yep. And the American Farmland Trust study was done specifically for 3 towns. It was done for Agawam, it was done for Deerfield, and it was done for Gill. The 1992 study showed very clearly that for every dollar paid in taxes, the homeowners, the residents, got $1.12 back for it. And for every commercial and industrial that they got back, for each dollar they paid, they got back 41 cents in benefits. Now, if they're getting 41% back in benefits out of a $2.2 million budget, one of the solutions that I would propose to you is that we should turn around and dedicate and save $500,000 a year to put into the sewer fund, because that's why businesses came here. Most of them came here. There are some businesses that didn't, but the majority of businesses came here for that purpose. To give you an example of how good that is, Yankee Candle wanted to get in, and they didn't want to put in another septic system like they had in their old building. So when they put the new building in, they paid to have that thing run across the field and all the way down and went under Route 5 and 10 and tied it in by the fire station. They're willing to pay that money just because there's value in the thing. And if you look at page 3, you'll see on page 3 that they are one of our bigger taxpayers in town.
Yep.
$251,000. That's a nice little tax tab that we get from them. What I'm saying is, let's use some of their money. Don't raise your taxes anymore, but let's use some of their money and let's dedicate it for what it should be dedicated for. It should be dedicated to support and help the taxpayers for the sewer system. To give you another example, when I was on the board, I turned around and I was fortunate enough to be there when Berkshire Brew came in. They gave us a story, and the story went something like this. We went to Springfield, gave them the same story we're going to give you tonight. They threw us out. We went to Greenfield, told them the same thing exactly, and they threw us out. Now we'd like to tell you our story, and their story was that they needed to find a place where they could be on a town sewer because it was necessary for their business. And I said, I thought about it real quick, and it didn't take long or hard thinking to say, congratulations, I think I'd like to see this brewery come to the town of Deerfield. because it adds to our tax base, and that's what we try to do. We always try to add to our tax base. Now, currently, their tax tab is almost $20,000, and if you add the motor vehicle tax, they're up to like $23,500 of benefit for the town of Deerfield. And guess who gets all that money that comes in from taxes? It's spread out amongst everybody, including non-sewer users. So they've been getting a free ride, or not a free ride, they've been getting a good deal for the last 15 years since this tax policy went in. And I'd like to see it change, and I'd like to ask you to consider for the next annual town meeting changing that, because that is only good for the town of Deerfield, and since they're paying a big share of taxes, over 22%, there's no reason why they can't turn around and we can't use some of that money. And yet, the non-sewer users will have seen their taxes go up a little bit. But guess what? The tax users, the sewer users, will also go up in taxes too. And that benefit subsidizes everybody in the town of Deerfield.
I think, that, John, that there's a realization that the whatever repairs there are going to be are going to be very extensive, so it would have to be shared.
Well, what I'd like to say to you, what you said, John, before we get too far away, is that you said that, in this case, Yankee Candle paid $225,000 in property taxes.
Right there. Right, it's on top of the list.
It's an $850 million corporation. I'm a single individual, and I pay over $25,000 in, you know, personal property tax, I mean, in real estate tax. I pay another $7,000 in personal property tax for my vehicles are registered. Every year, I spend about $1,500 have my septic systems pumped out and stuff like that. I can't come to the town and ask them to subsidize that. And when I did put up a new building, the sewer system, because it was a pumped one, cost me $26,000. So if you break that down, I pay basically $200 every month for my own sewer system. And if that fails, I have to pay that. So I'm not sure what the number is, how many people in town have septic systems versus the sewer use. I think we have about 850 sewer users.
Sewer users, and the majority are non-sewer users.
Yeah. So, you know, it's if you get to the point where all the taxpayers have to pay in, then we're going to have to think about a way to create something to help the people who have septic systems to maintain them or to replace them. And I think that would be very difficult and catastrophic.
Well, I think that's something I totally agree with you. What you have to do is you have to find a way of allowing $200 or $300 every 2 years to help them defray the cost of pumping. If you don't defray the cost of pumping, guess what happens? Yeah. Your system plugs up, and they rot out, and then you get nothing. I'll give you another example.
John, I hate to interrupt, but we're going to take a few-minute break here to do the tax classification hearing. So don't have to do anything.
Don't go away, Matt. Just go away.
No. Just sit right there.
Don't even go away.
John Cordair, could you? Are you here singly? You're just here by yourself, right?
I'm here by myself.
Oh, well then, John, could you push the
I'll give him the microphone.
Microphone over to John so that John could come up, and I'll read this. I'd like to have the tax classification hearing to comply with Mass General Laws, Chapter 40, Section 56. The Deerfield Board of Selectmen will conduct a hearing to determine the residential factor on the allocation of the local property tax levy among the five property tax classifications for the next fiscal year. The Board of Assessors will provide all the information and data relevant to making such a determination and the fiscal effect of the available alternatives. The Commissioner of Revenue will not approve the tax rate until the selectmen have held such a hearing and until the town has adopted the percentages of the local tax levy to be borne by each class of real property. The hearing will be held in the main meeting room, municipal offices at 8 Conway Street, South Deerfield, Mass, on Wednesday, November 9th, 2016, at 7 p.m. All interested taxpayers may present written or oral information, and your comments will be received. This was posted in the municipal offices on November 3rd, 2016, and published in the Recorder on November 5th, 2016. John, would you like to go ahead and?
Yes. The Board of Assessors is proposing a tax rate of $15.40 for the coming fiscal year, 2017.
It was $15.40?
$15.40.
Okay.
It's up 15 cents from last year. It was $15.25. In coming up with that figure, we took into account a lot of things. First of all, there are black and white things such as what you voted to spend, what the town voted to spend at the town meetings, special and annual town meetings. And various funds, if you took money from free cash to pay for some of that, that's taken into account. There are two items that are somewhat of a judgment call on the part of the assessors, and we do that based upon conferring with everyone involved. We conferred with the town accountant on estimated receipts, for example, and Brenda felt that some of the estimated receipts in our initial thinking were high. So we've lowered the estimated receipts to what we think is a manageable number, one that Brenda is happy with, and one that we think we are happy with. The other thing that is taken into account is overlay. And since we're in a research year, we felt that we didn't want to go too low with overlay in case we had a lot of abatement requests and et cetera. So we ended up with a $15.40 rate. The purpose of this hearing is to decide whether you want to have that rate applied across the board to residential, commercial, and industrial. Historically, we've always done that. The assessors recommend that it's a single rate. If we adopted some variation, we could have a real mess on our hands, because don't forget we have three other districts that tax. We had a hearing at 6:30 with the South Deerfield Water District, and they voted to retain a single rate. So you're going to have somewhat of a nightmare if you move it, but you should be aware of it. If you wanted to change and have different rates for commercial and industrial, I'll give you the wide view. The lowest you could get the residential is down to $12.87. So from $15.40 down to $12.87. That would increase commercial and industrial to $23.10.
John, I just want to tell you that, you know, all the meetings I've ever attended and all the information that I've ever read says that the single rate is the most, unless you want to nab somebody on the way out, you know, a commercial person that was moving out of town, you would always want the single rate. So I guess I'm very supportive of single rate. We've always had the single rate. So I feel very comfortable making the motion for the single rate. I don't know.
I agree with you as well.
Yeah.
The other thing that I'm sure a lot of people don't understand or know is that if you did adopt a commercial rate, it would be applicable to farmers too. So farmland would be assessed at the higher rate.
Yep.
Instead of this too.
I think we need to say that so that people understand that farmers not only would be stressed about many other things, but their tax bills would be unaffordable.
One other thing I have to inform you of is in doing between the estimated receipts and the overlay, the other thing that's left is the levy limit. And with our initial figures and looking around, we were coming up with an excess levy limit of somewhere around $150,000. That was when we were looking at a reduced rate. That means we were leaving $150,000 on the table, and it would be gone forever. In talking with Carolyn and talking with Brenda, actually even talking with Terry Williams, who is our DOR, one of our DOR people, it was suggested that we shouldn't leave that on the table, especially in view of the coming years when we could be looking at some substantial increases. So, saying that, when we come up with the $15.40 rate, we're close to our levy capacity. We're leaving $14,791.97 as the excess.
Okay.
And it,
that's pretty good, John.
We can't get any closer.
Right. No, that's excellent, John. I just want to tell you, I didn't. You know, last Thursday was the MMA nomination work that I told you I would follow up on, and nobody seemed to know what that Medicare reimbursement was. And did you find out what it was?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Is that recurring? Because John Robinson from the MMA didn't know anything about it.
It used to be listed under a figure of, I gotta find the sheet here.
So we were getting it all along.
It used to be listed under miscellaneous recurring. Yeah.
Okay.
DOR decided that it's significant enough that it should be shown as a separate line item on the recap sheet.
Okay.
So we have now got to put it on the recap sheet. It has to do with students in our schools.
Oh, okay.
We have to pay up front, and we have contracted with Pioneer.
This is a reimbursement for the medical part of special ed?
Yes.
Okay. Yes, now I understand where it's coming from. I'll get back to John Robinson on that because he couldn't understand.
It's fairly new. Well, it's fairly new in terms of having it on the recap sheet that way.
Yes.
And in a lot of cases, communities weren't putting it in.
No, we have, though. We've been doing it at least 10 or 12 years.
We have under miscellaneous non-recurring is where we've had it in the past.
Yeah.
But
I know we've been doing it because when it was one time, John, that we went to the MMA meeting and we went to that class and they told us about it and then we started having the schools reimburse. And that's how we've been getting the money. But it changes every year because it's based on the percentage of related to the special ed that's medical.
Right. We pay it. Then it goes through this Pioneer Valley Collaborative.
Yes. And they submit the cost for us.
They bill Medicaid, and Medicaid reimburses us, and then we pay Pioneer Valley like 10% of what they collect.
It was cheaper that way than doing it ourselves,
right,
because
exactly.
You have to know how to file it.
Yep.
And that was why we had set it up that way. So yes, it does cost us to file it, but then we get reimbursed.
Right.
And that's part of the special ed costs that we pay in the yep. school budget. But it does come back to us.
It does.
Yeah. Okay. Well, so I make that motion.
To retain the single rate. I'll yes. second the motion.
Is there any further discussion?
No.
Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, thank you, John.
I just need your signatures on one piece of paper, and that is that I have told you that the excess capacity is $14,791.97.
Perfect.
Was that all planned?
Yes. Oh, yeah, no, blue is better. I just had a black pen.
Down the bottom, Barbara's got a sign.
Okay.
Barbara mixed up all of
that. Just
yep. Any one of those. Oh, I think you've just got a pen. Yeah, you've got a good pen.
Got a black one.
It doesn't matter. It's just I had only this pen. It's not legal. Yeah.
That's fine.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, John.
Thank you very much, John.
Okay, we will reopen our sewer informational questions with John. So I'm sorry to interrupt you, John.
Not a problem. John wanted to agree with me anyway. He just doesn't know it yet. I was saying the American Farmland Trust did this study, and the study proves conclusively that you don't get an adequate amount of services compared to what you're paying taxes if you're commercial and industrial.
Yes, that's true.
And that everybody should know, but they don't seem to know it. And what happens is when you take $2 million and include it into the $10 million, they don't realize that they're being subsidized by business, and the majority of the business is business that came here because of the sewer. Mm-hmm. Then I explained to you about the Berkshire Brew. They pay $23,000-$24,000 in taxes every year, and they don't get value for that. Another thing I just found out about was, for years, and I was only on the board for 18 years, for during those 18 years, we've always maintained 1 year in advance of whatever the cost of running the sewer was in reserve. So we had $500,000-$700,000 that I know of for at least over 20 years now. And if you take a look at where that money is kept, it's kept in the town coffers. The town coffers, they turn around and just add it in. And guess who gets the benefit of the interest from that money? All the taxpayers in the town of Deerfield get benefit.
John, we changed that. After you brought that up, we
voted. I didn't bring it up, Bruce did. I got to give credit to Bruce.
We changed it immediately.
Thank you.
But that was a good catch.
And then I want to also point out that it's unfair that the town buildings don't pay sewer charges when they should be paying water charges and sewer charges like everybody else.
Yeah,
and I know you're going to change that next year.
Yeah.
Thank you for that.
That's one of the sewer committee's recommendations.
Yeah, they've all been notified, even the schools.
I know, I saw a copy. Yeah.
Okay.
I could hear better if I was at
home. Yes, ma'am.
Question in the back there.
Is he done?
Yes, yeah, well.
Probably so not. My last comment is this. I want to make sure you're fair to all, to include sewer users and non-sewer users. And you'll get a controversial viewpoint saying, oh, no, we got to pay for all of this sewer cost ourselves. One friend of mine says, who do you get to engineer services for a sewer? I said, why do you ask that? He says, because my neighbor across the street has a sewer system, his own septic system, and he says the thing's not working, so it's a failed system. So he asks some engineer to change it. I said, well, what's the problem with it? He says, well, the guy lived there for 40 years and he never pumped it. So you can see that thing's got to be just plugged full. So anyway, I know there's a cost associated with replacing septic tanks, leach fields, D-boxes, and all that other stuff. And I totally agree that something should be done. But this is a time, and the sewer study committee is working on that and trying to come up with a recommendation for the Board of Selectmen.
So my final comment is, be fair to everybody.
John, I can honestly say that's what we're trying to do.
Oh, I know that.
We are really trying to be thoughtful.
So.
Yes, ma'am.
I guess I came with something like that. I guess what I want to address is what everybody keeps repeating about fair and equal. So I guess my initial question would be, upon what is the minimum usage based? And I want to know how many people in town are in my situation who use 8,000 gallons of water per cycle. And is it the same rate? Obviously, it must be. For a single-person household and multi-person households.
Do you want to come up and have a seat?
Sure.
Thank you.
Want me to face them or face you?
No, face us, yeah.
It's fine.
Or either way. Whatever.
Oh, well, you I think it probably right is
there.
Good
yeah.
That...
Sit there and you can talk into the microphone.
It's not a help if you can see it. There's a lot of numbers.
Oh.
I literally took my water and my sewer gun. Now, what I just paid, and then based upon the new one, my last two bills... where I had usage of 8,700 gallons, and before that, 8,200 gallons. This summer, I tried to conserve water because of the drought. Well, obviously, I'm not going to save any money. The ones who are saving money are the lodge families and the lodge users if they try to conserve. Right now, the minimum gallon is roughly 5,950 per 1,000. I paid last time, where is it now? 58.64 for my water usage, $25 for the service fee, a total of $83.64. The new rate is based on 11,110 gallons, more than double. Divided by that, it comes out to $99.99 a gallon. The sewer rate is commission has decided 100, but I figure I'm close enough. Remember, the rate comes out twice a year. If I use 8,700 gallons, per 1,000 gallons is irrelevant. It doesn't pertain to me. I automatically have to pay $100. And on top of that, a service fee that's gone up from $25 to $100, twice a year now we're talking.
Four times.
So what I am paying more than twice a year is I am paying almost $233 more for water that I do not use. With the minimum proposed, okay, with the minimum proposed, I should be paying $9 per 1,000 like all of you, or most of you, I should say, excuse me. However, because of the minimum rate, and I have to pay $100, I am paying $11.49 more for the water, sewer, you are paying only $9 for. That's more than $3 times 2 is $12. Twice a year. You know, you're going to say it's a little money, but this has been happening since I first got my house. I'm a single person household, I'm on a fixed income, and every little bit counts. You keep saying equally pay and equally turn in, but yet you set a minimum. I should run my faucets all day to meet your minimum. That minimum should also apply to me. I should be able to meet that minimum or not have to pay that extra. This is extra money I'm paying that nobody else is paying. So I'm like paying two penalties. I'm paying the penalty for the service fee, which all of us pay. But then I'm paying the penalty because I don't use enough water. And that doesn't make sense. And that's not only a problem with the sewer commission, it's also a problem with the water department. They have their same minimum of $20 you have to pay. My water bill comes to eight something. I pay $20. I pay $12 to $13 more each cycle for water I do not even consume. Equal?
I can explain that to you. The thing is, when we just talked about all of this, we have a lot of problems going on. When you flush your toilet, I'm not sure where you live, but it doesn't matter. When you flush your toilet and it goes down the pipe and it goes all the way, more than likely, when you flush your toilet, you're using about a gallon of water. That gallon of water has to take whatever you flushed, maybe a mile or half a mile, all the way to the sewage treatment plant. The problem is that you don't use enough water, and so the pipes start to get plugged up, and it builds up and builds up. So then we have to rent a very expensive machine, or we have to buy an expensive machine at the tune of $500,000 to clean out the pipes. So through conservation of water to trying to keep your sewer bill low, you're actually plugging up the pipes. And it happens with everybody. And the problem gets worse. Now, let's just say everybody's waste gets all the way to the plant with very little water. Now it's very difficult to treat. It costs the community more money to run the equipment. We have to buy more chemicals to treat it. We have to treat it for a longer period of time because when the water goes into the river, it has to meet a standard. So all of these problems keep adding up, which adds to the cost of running the plant. That's why we decided that if we set a minimum of $100, we would hopefully curtail water conservation because even like with the water department, they need so much money to operate. And if people keep conserving, trying to save their bill, keep their bill low, the problem just gets worse because people are using less water, so they're getting less revenue, but they still need so much revenue to run.
So you're telling us we can't save?
You can't.
Right.
Because what's going to happen is I'm not trying to scare anybody, but there's a real possibility within the next 5 years that you're going to be paying somewhere around $100 to $150 a month for your sewer. That's how much it costs to fix this stuff. And it isn't that we want to do it. It's just, but when you flush your toilet, you want it to work. And it's a very crucial part of life.
But those of us who are single families and using less water are being penalized. We're being penalized. I just told you I'm paying 11 something instead of $9 by your new system.
One of the things...
Is that fair and equal? You're telling me use more water? I can't afford to be useful.
But what I'm saying to you is that one of the things that we spoke about at the sewer study committee was not having it based on water at all. We're just going to send you a bill for $100 every month. So every month you'd pay that $100 bill. It doesn't matter how much water you use because our issue isn't with the amount of water that's going down. It's what's going down there. You know, it's created a problem in that it's kind of like the schools. You know, whether you have kids or not, there's an expense to having it. And maintaining all of these pipes and the pumps and everything, it just costs a lot of money. And, you know, the people and the businesses that do use a lot more do pay a lot more. One of the things that the sewer study committee is looking at is we're going to propose three different rates. One is for commercial industrial, another is an institutional rate, and then the residential rate.
We just voted on having one rate.
No,
that was
that's
the
different.
Tax
that's,
rate.
That's tax rate. This is a sewer rate. Oh, I know. If you think it's confusing, it's like.
I think it should be one.
I got books.
The same.
You're talking about being fair.
Yeah.
The institutional rates are the nonprofits. The commercial rates use different water amounts. I actually am one of the ones that had a problem with. You know, conservation being penalized. But when you talk, when we had the explanation that it actually costs more, you are costing the users, the way you use the system, actually everybody is bearing the burden of your cost of the use because the way you use the system costs more to process because there's nothing to process it with. And it's getting stuck. I know, but that's what the problem is.
And I don't need much.
Right.
So, but it costs more.
But it still costs
the system is.
But it's not equal to have me paying for something I don't use.
If you say $9 is the rate,
then $9 should be the rate for me as well as everybody.
But people are paying more for you because they have to subsidize your use.
No, people are paying more because they're using more water.
But you need more water than I am.
They're using more water than I am using. That's why they're paying more. I'm paying the exact same service fee that they are paying. So they're not paying any more on that end. They're using more water. How many people in town use 8,700 gallons of water?
Actually, there's quite a few people.
Quite a few.
Okay.
You're not
alone. So you're making a lot of money on us
part
then.
Of it.
But
we're not making the money. The issue is that there's such a massive amount of infrastructure
so
cost.
So find something else. You're talking about grants. How can you set the rate to go into effect on January 1st when you just said you're not going to hear about the next grant until January
15th? We set it every year.
We have to set legally.
But if you know you're going to get a grant, shouldn't the fact whether you get a grant
and raise the
rates affect it?
We have no idea that we're going to get the grant.
So maybe you need to wait.
We can't wait. By law, you have to set it.
So maybe it should be the same until you find out you get a grant.
But you have costs that you need to set.
So what if you get the grant? Are we going to get a refund?
No, because that won't even cover
a
portion of what you need to do. There's so much work that needs to be done that hasn't been done in this town for many, many years.
I'm not arguing that. What I'm arguing is the fact that those of us who are single family households are being penalized.
But what would you do? What would you do tomorrow morning if you woke up and your toilets were backed up and you called the plumber and he said, "I'm sorry, but it's your pipe's clean, but when it goes into the road, the pipe's broken." Now this same scenario happened on North Main Street. Would you be willing to pay $3,000 or $4,000 to repair that pipe? No,
it's not
you
my
would.
Pipe, it's a town
exactly.
Pipe.
Where does the town get
so
the money
So where are all my taxes going? My taxes go up every year, and I haven't done
for
one solid
thing
well,
in
my
items.
House. Everybody's taxes are going up.
It is amazing.
But
I mean, you take
if you don't do anything to your house, how can it be revalued for a heck of a lot more than what you paid for, and it's the same?
I hear you.
You know?
We
so
feel your pain.
In that way, you're making the money. You are getting the income on taxes. We all have the same tax base. Well, that's fine.
Enough.
We all have the same service fee. Well, that's fine. We all don't have the same water usage fee. And that's what I really, really, really do not approve of. Not when you keep saying equal. And like I said, the water department does the exact same thing as you do. Not you, but the sewer does.
They have costs to cover for the infrastructure to run the system.
I understand that, but I'm paying more towards that cost than other people.
Can I? Go ahead. Yeah, you have a question?
I'm Rosalie Beck. I live on Eastern Avenue, and I've been down there for 60 years. I've never once, I alone, have never had occasion to be a nuisance to the sewer department. We've never had any problems. But when my bill is going to double, and it says that the sewer study committee has made this pronouncement, quadrupling the service fee is a what? I'm dismayed that not one of them is here. You're taking all the heat.
Well, ma'am, I'm one of the members. I'm the chair of that board.
Where are the other seven?
But we're the sewer. This board is the sewer commissioners.
Yes.
Okay. The sewer study committee. They're working on recommendations going forward. This was our doing.
The study committee is essentially.
Well, they recommended that we start
done
with this.
With what they. We're supposed to do.
No. They're just getting started.
They're just getting started. This is one of their first recommendations.
Oh, they got started with a bang.
You're right about that.
I don't want to scare you, but it is going to get a lot worse. It just kind of has to.
And that's why people move out of town.
But for a good example,
homes that they've had for many years.
I know.
The people in Amherst.
We're
I know,
Amherst,
I understand that, but people in Amherst and the average homeowner in the state of Massachusetts who are on public sewers pay close to $75 every single month. And that's why when we try to get some of the money, the state just says, Deerfield doesn't need it. You know, you the rates that you have are ridiculously low. And consequently, you can fund all this yourself.
So when you're conserving and not bothering the sewer plant or the services, you get punished.
Well,
when you have are economical, the state punishes you. Mm. There's something wrong with this picture.
Yeah. Well, a lot of it has to do with the cost of everything,
goes,
you know?
I think of all those buildings over there, et cetera, et cetera. I don't see any comparison between Amherst and Deerfield. Apples and oranges, I'm sorry.
I'm not comparing the towns. I'm just
Amherst should necessarily
That was an average of across the state, average people that are not just Amherst, but just average users pay a lot more for water. I talk to coworkers that live in Agawam and stuff, and the cost of their water is just tremendously higher than Deerfield. I was amazed at when I would get my water bill, I'd fill up my pool or water the lawn, and you know, and I'd get a bill for, you know, I can't even think of it offhand.
That depends on where you go. My sister lives in a big city. Single family household does not water her lawn like I do.
Of course not. No, I'm just saying
she pays less for water than I do.
Yeah, well then again it depends on the infrastructure. But I'm saying that the Deerfield's rates have been low for a long time. It is a big increase. I understand your frustration, but we need to build this infrastructure. We have to fix it. If this stuff starts going into the river, you're not going to like the fines that we're going to get. I mean, we the changes from the state and what we can pump into the river are getting stricter and stricter all the time. Our infrastructure is getting older and older all the time. We have to make these investments in it, and it's painful. It's pain. We'd much rather not raise the rate or put the money towards a senior housing or there's so many different ways that we'd love to spend the money, but at some point we have to start addressing the needs of the town. And we're at one of those points now, and we'll get more information from the sewer study committee among what we need to do, where we need to go forward. This was granted a large step to start with, but it was half of what was recommended. So we're trying to be conservative, but it's painful. Painful to have to pay that, and especially if you're a single person living on your own.
Do you have a game plan over the next like 20 to 30 years to start replacing infrastructure?
That's what they're working on.
That's what the steward.
It's about $30 million worth of repairs.
That's just the plants themselves, is that the infrastructure in the streets?
No, that's just the plants themselves.
What about the piping in the streets?
That's additional. I mean, some of the pipes are really, really old, so I don't know. But some of them have been upgraded.
You know,
so
for years they've done sewer studies, smoke tests.
Yep.
And we were required by the state, that used up quite a lot of the reserve that John was talking about. We were required by the state to do the to cut our infiltration. In other words, the water, every time it rained, the water went in the ground, and then it went into the sewer system, and we treated it. And it actually was a benefit to our sewer system because we had enough water to process. So we were required by the state to shut off everybody's sub pumps in their cellars. They had to be off, otherwise we were going to get fined. And we had to do all the smoke tests to determine the worst infiltration, and we had to do those repairs. So some of the piping is really in pretty good shape because we had to replace it already. We had to meet the bar set by the state. As a consequence, we don't have enough water to process what is flushed down the toilets because people, are conserving. And I'm one of the ones that had real problems that this was penalizing conservation because, in this day and age, water and drought and everything, it seems not right to punish people that, flush a couple times a day versus someone that's flushing every 5 minutes, if you have a big family or whatever, or people taking showers all day. And that's why I'm very supportive of institutional rates and commercial rates, because we have people that are using water at a much higher rate, and hopefully that will offset some of the, I feel, penalty for not, having some kind of conservation rate. Because I do agree that the single households are
And people tend to use less water, and you want to conserve, you know, in this day and age. So I feel it's terrible, but we're torn. We don't really have a choice.
Usually those are the people that are on a fixed income.
Yep.
You know, they're one left in the house, the kids are gone, and you're getting penalized.
Is there a tiered rate for sewer usage? Residential versus commercial?
That's what they're looking forward to in the future.
We only have one rate at the moment, but that's one of the, because our rates are so low, it's making us have a hard time getting these grants to do the repairs. And so we're looking at a rate structure that will hopefully, we have to generate more money and other to be considered for the grants, which will save the taxpayers money.
Right.
So they have to do something, and that was one of the things that we were looking at.
I had just off to change it a little bit. On the bottom of that paper you sent home, what's the summer usage, like a refund or something like that? Can somebody explain that?
Sure. If you, just for example, say for your winter usage, you use 10,000 gallons of water, and that's what you're billed for. Then in the summertime, you use 15,000 gallons. Say you wash your car a lot or you water your lawn. I believe there's a rebate for 25%, or your bill will not be increased more than 125% of your winter use. So you'd get would be entitled to a rebate for however many gallons. Because
but
those
that's only for the people who use more water. Those of us
right.
who don't
Correct.
Are
well,
eligible for any kind of rebate.
And because all the water that goes through your house, whether it's for a garden, for your lawn, or washing your car, is metered, but it's not going into the sewer system.
Right.
And that's why it's like that. But one of the things that we've seen, which happens a lot in the Commonwealth and around the country, is they don't even do that. They just send people a flat bill, depending on the size of your house or the number of bedrooms. So if you have a two-bedroom house, I'm just picking these numbers up, you might get a bill for $50. If you have a three-bedroom house, it'll be $75. If you have a four-bedroom house, it'll be $100. If you have a five-bed, you know, something like that. Commercial rates would actually be higher. Institutional rates would be higher. You know,
but rather than going by bedroom rates, it'd be more equitable if you went by the number of people in the household.
That's too hard to police.
It's more equitable.
So, but, you know, if you live in your house all by yourself, I don't know, but let's just say you have family. They come over for the weekend. Is somebody supposed to be there and charge you extra money because there's more people use on the weekends? You know, so it's a very difficult thing to do.
Well, suppose I never have company, nobody ever
right.
stays over.
I know.
And
I
have
know.
Four bedrooms.
Yeah.
But only one person is ever in that house.
Yeah. It's a tough situation.
It's like
yeah, it
it's
but it's
very similar to families have four kids that go into the school and the lady next door has already raised her kids, they're gone. She's still paying the taxes to put the kids through school. So it's not always equitable.
Yeah, so am I. I'm not complaining about that.
No, but I'm just trying to make the analogy that it's similar. Sometimes we do pay more for the common good. And
well, it's not similar because you set a $9 rate,
mm-hmm.
and you tell some of us we have to pay $11.50.
Yeah, I'm
it's
not,
not
sure where
equitable
that comes from.
In that
but
sense. You set a rate, and then you break it. And I'm not going to say anymore.
Oh, okay.
Yes, sir.
I think that there are complexities of running a town, a city, or a business that are made up of a lot of puts and takes. And I think that when I received this letter, I looked at it and I thought, okay, I understand that there's a bigger picture here, right? And you know, it's like, I forget how we did it in town meeting, Ms. Ness, so I'm just going to say select person because I can't remember how they wanted you addressed.
I actually can't even remember.
But, you know, you addressed the fact that we had a water commissioner or a sewer commissioner that didn't keep us abreast of what the situation might be. But I think that where the frustration comes from, we saw it evident when we woke up this morning and we realized that we had a new president that 2 days ago nobody thought we were going to have, and it's been, you know, metered out by the press as this is the frustration that we see across our country. My frustration as a taxpayer is in the puts and the takes. I don't understand why we have a volunteer fire department that has a seven-figure, you know, kitty of money for a volunteer fire department. I think that there is a taxpayer, is a put and a take
where I could have more money put back in my pocket and I wouldn't be as upset about a $150 service fee cut. Mm-hmm. I look at the Community Preservation Act, which at the town meeting I heard had $1 million in their kitty. I don't know if there's $1 million worth of Preservation Act, and I'm not saying that we take that money for something else, but if we reduce the percentage, because when we voted on that at town meeting here in this very room, we went all the way to the max. If somebody said, you're going to have to pay an extra $150 for this, but we're going to reduce you $150 over here, and as a guy that has two kids in college and one that's in high school, you know, facing that very daunting prospect, because if you have children in that environment, you know that those are not, you know, I'll gladly swap my tuition bill to pay all of your service bills, okay?
Yep.
But my point is, I don't believe that the broader complexity of running a town, at least in Deerfield, and with two new members of the board selected, now I found out you are now also the sewer board, I think that we need to look at saying, all right, we have all of these revenue streams. How do we reduce some of those revenue streams and put that money back in the taxpayer pocket? Whether it be community preservation, whether it be a volunteer fire department that has another volunteer fire department on the other side of town, which, again, you know, I have a state university education, maybe I can't do the mental arithmetic why that is, probably needs to be changed, and it's just, you know, the way the town's always run. I moved here 15 years ago. So what I struggle with, and I think that you probably have to struggle with, is the frustrations of the taxpayers continually being asked, we need a new roof for the school. Mm-hmm. We have, you know, the South Canopy, you know, EMS that, you know, for 2 years now has operated on a pretty significant budget and has no real plan to generate revenue, and maybe they can't. That's fine. But I think that we, as a town, and as a leadership executive committee, we need to start thinking about how do we start not just taking, and how do we start to put back a little bit? Because at some point, the broader question is, who wants to move, right? Mm-hmm. I moved here for one simple reason. Deerfield Elementary School had a principal that when I met him by the name of Doug Tierney, told me that his goal was to have the finest elementary school in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. I put a down payment on a property the very next day. So why would people want to move here? They're not going to want to move here if they pay $10,000 a year in taxes. I didn't move to Amherst because the house that I looked at had $10,000 a year in property taxes. I paid $10,000 a year in property taxes here. I never bitch, I never complain, but I think at some point we have to think about the puts and takes. We can't have a Community Preservation Act with $1 million in the kitty. There's only so many cemeteries to redo, there's only so many playgrounds to build, and there's only so many farmers that are going to, you know, sell us their property in lieu of building low-income housing. And so I think that the challenge to the board and the challenge to the people in the town is maybe, A, look at how do we look at the puts and takes, and maybe people will be less frustrated. Maybe, you know, this young woman here won't be so aggravated if we put another $150 in her pocket from another bucket, because the greater good is we're going to have plugged up sewers at some point, and $30 million, that's a big nut for a town of several thousand residents. Yes. You know, I appreciate what you guys do. You know, people, I sat in this room when I voted and somebody said you should become a select person, and I said, you know, I don't think that I'm smart enough to do it. So I thank you for what you guys do, the two new people, and Ms. Ness, you've been here for a long time. But I do think the challenge to you guys is if you don't want people coming here and spending their entire afternoon trying to figure out what their water bill looked like, put $150 back in your pocket from the Community Preservation Act and figure out how that works.
I wish it were that easy.
I wish it was that easy. That's what I said. Can I just, yes.
There's complexities in running a town that no people ever know.
We'd like to, go ahead.
I sat where you sat, and I'm a very busy person, and I made a commitment about a year ago that I wanted to run for this position. And I was very fortunate enough, I had enough folks to believe in me. Prior to my election, there was a meeting in here to spend in excess of $3 million for the school roof. I just happened to spend 40-something years in the construction business. It drove me crazy. I stood up and I tried to explain to the community why this was so outrageous. Our school department argued against me, says, we had to do this, we had to do that. Well, I was elected and I took on the project. I think initially our project came in at about $700,000 under budget,
and through a lot of hours of my own time, I think we got it down another $50,000 or $60,000. So we basically saved about $850,000 from the original budget. And even at that, if it was done, or I consider the right way, it would have been another $800,000 less. So the only point that I can make to you is that whenever you hear of something where money's going to be spent, get involved, come and sit,
please,
talk to people. I know it takes time, even. But you know,
I sat with him through every meeting because we had to come and be a quorum.
Because that's a put.
And
that's
frustration.
That's a put.
Yep.
But I understand.
Help me understand.
I just
why you know.
So that
you see Dave from 3 to 2, and guess what?
But just a second. We have $1 million in the bank. I had to put 4 kids through college, and I'm still paying. They were all in college at the same time. So I certainly understand what you're saying. But I just want to say that people, the CPA is a target, but that $1 million in the bank, half of it is from the state. And we're reinvesting in our community. And that million is not enough. The reason why it's sitting there is because we need to renovate the senior center and we need to build senior housing. And we seriously need between $2 to $3 million to do that. So we have to hang on to it for a few more years. Yes, it's looking, you know, like we have this big amount of money there, but the state is matching it 100% of whatever dollar we put in there. So whatever is in there, 50% is not even ours.
As 3 easy targets, right?
Yes,
right.
But I do want to say that we do have a long-range plan for that. We are trying to have senior housing in town, truly subsidized senior housing, not just senior housing that, you know, but senior housing that people would pay only 30% of their income, so that seniors, and it's mostly older women, have a place to live. But it would be couples and men too. I'm not saying that, but we are trying to take care of that, and hopefully that will move forward.
I have two cents to add, and I'll get to you.
I would like to ask this gentleman a question. You mentioned the big amount of money that the fire department has.
I'm not really certain because there are meetings, they're held in top secret, you have to have a special handshake, and then it goes on to the board to get into those meetings. I don't know how they work.
Probably is true.
They'll laugh off, like,
poor fireman.
I'll find something for you. The town does not support the fire department.
And I understand that, and that's a problem that
you
I have.
Don't know
because
that?
We support the police department right next door. So
the
why
police
is the fire
department
police?
Gets money from the town. The fire department does not.
Right.
It is a separate entity. The meetings are open to the public, as are all meetings. If you aren't there, it's your own responsibility.
No, I've tried. I've asked for their budget. I've asked for a copy of their.
I just want to.
I'm not going to fight with them. You know, I believe I grew up in the city. The fire in the city
understand.
And DPW should all be one happy family, right? And then,
so
you
don't
know,
talk
about how they're going.
But. I think you misunderstand that what money the fire department has is allocated for another truck or something. But the town, unlike the police department, does not support the fire department. So that you can't go in and say, okay, you've got $1 million, we need it for the town. Kick in or for the good of the town.
So
I don't want to dispute that.
May I?
I think they do a great job.
I'm well acquainted with working with the fire department.
May I say one thing?
Yes.
Please. I would love you to get involved. I mean, this is what this town needs. That's why I got involved. That's why Kip got involved. I know you're super busy. We'd love you on a board. We'd love you to come and just even come to meetings. I mean, we need your brain power. We need your involvement.
We need
your
yep.
Your speech you had. We need that. In this town, we need our citizens to get involved so that we can all make rational decisions. And I remember being in that seat and not knowing a lot. I mean, I've only been here a short time, but the short time I have been here, your eyes are really opened as to how everything works, and you realize it's not so much a conspiracy; it's just. There's a lot of moving parts. And so the more you can get involved, the more educated you are, the more you can educate other people, and you can change what you'd like
and
to have changed.
People have impact.
So we'd love it if you'd come to a board, you'd come jump on a committee somewhere. We need the help. So that's my two cents.
Yes.
I have a few more questions about the sewer.
Sure. Thank you.
There was some talk a while back, I guess, was it Bear Plastics over in Waitley wanted to tap into our sewer system?
Yes.
And we said no. But we don't have a lot of flow, you're saying, in the system? I mean,
yep.
People outside of our South River Water District buy water from the South River Water District at three times the rate. Why couldn't we have them? It's not like there's a lot of processed water, it's just bathroom water, have them tie in for three times the rate that us folks are paying. It would offset it for us. It would help, I think, with the flow, because the main line runs right down.
They decided not to do it.
What's
my,
that?
My understanding was they decided not to do it.
They decided not to do it, or we decided we're not going to let them do it?
No, because, well, we were trying to generate the rate, you know, a surcharged rate and a hookup charge.
Yep.
And then they decided not to do the expansion. For my, I mean, I'm trying to remember what we did, but we were talking about it in the meeting, a surcharge rate of 3 to 5 times what normal sewer users would do, plus a hookup rate, you know, a charge.
Yep.
And we were discussing it, and then they decided not to do that.
I think they went and had another study done, if I remember right, and they decided it wasn't worth it.
But also, I think besides the bathrooms, there was going to be some industrial waste that they were going to, say, keep there. But they, I think when our building inspector went over there, that there were pipes already, and they weren't unsure as to what was going to be going in there. So that was another sticking point.
And they fixed up their own septic system or something. I don't really know what happened, but we never finished the discussion with them.
I get you.
Yeah.
I remember reading articles in the paper and watching discussions on the
It would help with flow.
That would be a great source of income for us, since our flows are down since Oxford Pickle is gone.
Right.
And we don't, and the plant is below maximum capacity.
Well, we're only on one, you know, there's two areas, and we're only on one, actually.
Yeah. We do have a new reporter, but from my point of view, if you see an article in the paper, rip it in half, and only read half it, and you'll get just as much information.
No, accurate information. Mr. Kacharik had touched on was all the town buildings, do they pay sewer bill out of their budget?
As you know, the you know, once you start the budget year, it's really, I mean, everything is line items. So
it was not budgeted.
So we sent out a letter, you know, because the budgets are done at this time, a year ahead. So we had sent out a letter notifying the schools and everybody's budget is going to be included this year.
Kind of like the fire station doesn't pay, the water district doesn't pay, but they charge all the town buildings for water, but they don't pay for sewer.
So that's what we're changing that.
The town hall doesn't either. But my big concern was, especially with Frontier, even though they did pay a sewer bill, it was nowhere near, you know, equitable. And the thing with Frontier is that there's three other communities that go into it. So that should be part of their funding, too.
Well, definitely. And
it's going to change this coming year.
As you know, Steve, everybody has been accounting for costs and breaking it out. We did that with the highway department. We did that with the transfer station, so that we would stop subsidizing the transfer station. We did do that to the sewer users.
I know it takes time. I just was curious.
We're changing how everybody is operating and incurring the cost.
These little things that in turn affect all of us sitting
here. Well, I mean, it's like our health insurance. The town pays the health insurance. It's about $800,000 a year. And, you know, two-thirds of that, at least, is the elementary school employees. So, you know, we're breaking out the cost for each department, including the school department.
Well, it's just the cost of doing business.
Yeah.
And being an employer, basically.
Right. Yeah. But we're making the cost be associated with the actual operation, so people get an idea of what it costs
to
operate. Yeah.
You can't just run wild. Right.
Yes.
When is the going to start, exactly?
When is what?
Going to start.
This is for the new billing year. It begins, the fiscal billing year is the 2017, even though it's 16.
this is, you'll be getting your winter rate. I don't know, Barbara.
Is it November?
Yeah.
Yeah, always.
And then May in the summer. Yeah.
So the rate is going to increase the end of November?
The new rate. This is the new rate. Andy, and if you have any questions, you can call us, because Kip is not being fair to you. You are really good if you call us. So if there's any questions, we can clarify it.
I also know that Captain Lathrop, that road, that's on a pump system at the very end.
Yeah.
Where everybody else is gravity. So there's more cost into pumping that sewage than it is mine on Eastern Avenue or coming off of
and also the people.
Are they getting an additional charge for electricity from that? Because like Stage Road, I believe, is a pump system for water, and they get an additional charge onto their water bills, what I was told a while back, to offset that cost, so the rest of us users that are on a gravity system don't have to pay that.
At this point, no, but I have to say we've had problems with Captain Lathrop Drive that is not related to electricity, because electricity is more expensive, but what is more expensive is the constant cleaning out and burning out of the engine,
of the
pump system there, because somebody is using, people are putting down dental floss and flushables that are not flushable.
It's more the electricity, it's the infrastructure of the pump station, it's the labor twice, three times a week to go check on it, clean it out.
Yep.
I know there's replacement costs involved, but
it's a huge.
Basically, as a sewer user on the gravity side of the system, I'm offsetting theirs that costs more money than mine when I flush my toilet and physics takes over and it goes down to the sewer plant.
I think if they burn out one more engine or one more pump and we have to replace the pump, I think it will come down to a surcharge for that street.
Well, this has been, it's been,
I know,
a 40-year-old
I'll probably
system.
Get 50 million phone calls, but I have to say it is very aggravating, and I don't understand why people don't understand that you cannot flush stuff down the toilet like that. And
but
so
what I'm saying is
the whole system pays for that. The whole system, all the sewer users pay for
I'm
that
paying
pump.
For theirs.
Yes.
And mine costs basically nothing.
We've done educational outreach. We've handed out flyers. We've done everything we can.
So maybe, maybe you started charging, people would think a little bit more.
Maybe
you
would.
But it's hard. It's not
going to get addressed in, maybe the committee is thinking of all these different ways and how we do
this. We're thinking about how to do this.
It's a great point.
That's one of the biggest problems that the sewage treatment plant has is T-shirts, underwear, sneakers. You can believe the stuff, and it really wrecks the equipment.
Can you trace where that comes from and impose a fine?
Well, one of the things is we did buy a sewer camera that we has paid for itself already with blockages that we've been viewing. But I'm telling you, I feel like it's worth paying someone to run up and down the Captain Lathrop if we keep having problems, because.
And that's why I asked if you could trace where it comes from.
We need to start charging
fine.
People for the amount of time and effort that poor Kevin puts into Captain Lathrop's pump station, because it burns out all, and we're having people check it constantly. And it,
our system doesn't have enough screeners, the right type of screeners that are taking them out.
And that's one of the things that we're trying to fix.
Yeah.
And so, that might be what we have to do to surcharge and pay for the screens. I don't know. It's very frustrating because it's a direct cost. Just if an individual household has a septic system, I actually have to run my water. I have a well, but and it's a pump well, but I have to run the water because now that I'm in my house by myself, I don't, it used to be packed, but now there's periodically it's packed, but in general it's just me now. And so I have to run my water because for my septic system. So, I mean, I totally understand conservation and the need to conserve, but you also have to operate your systems. And this is one of the complications of the sewer system, and that's what the sewer committee is trying to come up with, a way to operate better and to have a more hands-on approach, which we haven't had in the past.
Now, you said like that our treatment plants are 50 years old, say. I think they're right around there. Are they?
They're around the 70s.
Yeah, 40 some odd years old. That pump station is probably right around the same era, correct? So that's going to need to be, you know, I'm just guessing $500,000 to $1 million to put a station like that today?
No, I don't.
With engineering costs and everything?
I don't think it's anywhere near that.
I don't.
It'd be a few $100,000, I would say.
Yeah, it'd be about $120,000, I believe.
That cheap?
Yeah. Well, I don't think it's cheap, but.
Well, the cost of the overall scope of everything else.
You don't generate a lot of money by charging people $100, $100,000 or $125,000 replacement is a lot of minimum charges.
Then again, that comes out of my pocket.
Yes.
Yes.
Absolutely.
And the people that don't live in that community.
You're right.
I agree.
Completely agree. Stuff's got to be addressed. So, I encourage you to attend the meeting.
So how much extra income is this going to generate for the
It's not. It doesn't really. Well, it generates more money, but it's not.
Right.
It's not going to be
sitting
idle. I know
about the town, but I mean for the just this rate increase, how much more is it going to generate?
What did you figure out?
It's.
Is it really going to make an impact?
It's going to raise it. Let me just give me a second here.
They picked the middle of the road.
It's going to raise the revenue $176,200. That's based on last year's water uses. So if everybody uses the same amount of water with these minimum fees, that's what it would generate.
Additional.
Right. Now, there's roughly 20% of the 850 users are at the minimum. About 40% are variable, and it's only the last 40% that it's much higher.
No, is this going to help us save to replace the two plants? Is
no.
What the goal is, or
no.
For it to offset the operating costs?
Neither. It's just going to go to pay to repair things that need to get fixed now.
We have a lot of things that need to be fixed right now?
Yeah. I mean, when I first...
Both plants?
Oh, yeah. But primarily here in Deerfield,
South Deerfield.
At the first couple of weeks when I was a selectman, I went to the sewage treatment plant and I asked the operator, and I didn't know the man, and I asked him to tell me what was wrong with it, and he basically told me you should blow it up because there's nothing right. So I did spend 3 hours walking through the place with him and learning what he does and stuff like that. And at the end of the 3 hours, he basically said, well, you know, it functions properly. We within our permit limits. We don't get fined, but you can see all the problems. And so I took it upon myself to come up with some, quick solutions to, address all the garbage that's going down the sewer system that shouldn't be in there. But then I found out that there had already been a study in place, and they were looking to spend $3.5 million on a new building and what's called a bar screen and a new headworks project, which helps clean this. And I basically told them I was not in favor of that at all, that I'd wanted another solution. Well, then all of a sudden this was supposed to be paid for 100% by some grant. And I said, well, as long as the taxpayers or ratepayers don't have to pay for this, I don't really care what you do to improve it. So now I just found out tonight that the grant is not coming through. So now we still have the problem, but it's going to be pushed off more. And I feel that we need to address this, because with all of the stuff going in there, it's just going to break more equipment and cause more problems. And what makes it difficult to work on this is that water flows 24/7. There's no valve to shut off to work on it. You constantly have to deal with the constant flow of sewage, and it makes it very tricky. So the sewer study committee, I think we've met about 8 times for about 3 hours each time, and we have a lot of smart people in there. We've come from a lot of different areas, engineering and things. We've gotten a lot of information from other communities, from our own consultants and stuff like that, and I'm sure that we're going to come up with an appropriate solution. It's just going to take some time, but the bottom line is it's going to cost money.
They have the same issues in the old Deerfield plant?
It's about $10 million from what I understand.
It's much smaller.
That's why
I want, and it's in the floodplain that we've had issues, so that's why it made sense to abandon it and pipe everything up in the north end to right to Greenfield, which their plan is just on the other side of the river. But
or part of our study too also talked about piping it, because if we repair this plant, modernize it, then
yep.
our flow could be increased and we could handle the sewage from, you know, old Deerfield. Then we could also pick up a lot of customers that would go right along Route 5.
Yeah, make the land North Main Street up more, I think, more viable and more money
right.
if you had sewer there.
Right. The businesses there are asking for it.
There's pieces of property there that'd be worth more money and
absolutely.
More viable for people to come in and put commercial property and get sewer.
Back in the 90s, I owned several pieces of property on Route 5 as well as I live on Route 5. And back in the 90s, I got all of my neighbors together, all the business owners, and we approached the town and we were willing to pay to put the pipe in. All we wanted to do was be able to connect to the sewer, and we weren't allowed to do it at the time. So I know that the folks along the highway would be willing to pay. I mean, even though it's a lot of money, I'd be willing to pay $10,000 for every property I have because I know what expense it is to, you know, deal with the septic systems and the limitations of it.
Yep.
You know, I've had to turn down businesses because, you know, I can't, you know, put the type of usage into a septic system that they require. So a lot of times I have to settle for less money for a tenant that's not going to require a lot of, you know, sewage.
But you have to understand that everybody has to agree to the betterment fee. So it's not just you're going to hook up.
Right. So, yeah, I understand.
I mean, everybody that wants to hook up and everybody that doesn't want to hook up is going to come into this meeting and have a big problem. So the best thing you can do is, again, keep applying for grants so that the grant pays for it and people are not on the hook for it. So, you know, then you can hook up for it and it's not a charge. So we will keep applying for grants. And
well, I understand where you're coming from by raising your rates and going to $100, but from going from $25 to $100, I think is awful steep. I mean, myself, I can afford it, but I'm not sure if there's others. I know there's people on limited incomes.
Yeah.
I understand the minimum, where that comes from, because, I mean, you just can't charge somebody for 3,000 gallons, even though it sounds like it's right to do, but
yeah.
There is expenses. I mean, those people are there 40 hours a week, every week, working, and
yeah.
No matter if you have a work form or not, they have to be there. I know it's a state law, and there's a requirement you have to have 3 or 4 people on staff. You just can't lay people off or make cuts.
Right.
I know.
It
is hard. And we are. All I can say is we're going to make every effort to keep applying for grants. And we are creative, and we do not give up. So chances are we'll eventually get a grant, and hopefully, you know, we can limp along in the meantime. And that's, you know, what we're trying to do. There'll be some things that we can do with that extra money that, you know, can hold off some of the other repairs. But we are facing some kind of major work, and it really, the entire town, as John Pichori alluded to, the entire town is responsible if there is a failure,
mm-hmm.
and it does go in the river. We have to, you know.
Yeah, I understand that. That's not fair to the non-sewer users.
Right. So, well, we are going to come up with something. I mean, that's why we have a sewer committee that can really focus on this, and it's a mix of sewer users and non-sewer users, so you can try to come up with an equitable, fair game plan.
What is our game plan to correct these $30 million issues we have?
We haven't laid that out yet. That's what the sewer committee is going to come up with in February.
Okay.
February or March, they're going to come up with a report. We've just been told that there's these $30 million worth of repairs plus, and plus is other infrastructure stuff, like your Kelleher Drive, Captain Lathrop, that's not even included in that. And so what we're trying to do is come up with, you know, some kind of...
I just don't want to see it being talked about for the next 5 to 10 years.
It
and
can't
the price increase
right.
5 to 10 times
You're
more
right. It can't. We got
than it already is.
Well, it will be talked about for quite a while because
yeah.
nobody has that kind of money.
Oh, I understand that.
And it takes time to apply for the, you know, every time you don't make the grant round, you have to do it another year or so. But hopefully...
Does the EPA have any type of low interest loans that they give to communities for stuff like this?
Here's the problem is that our rates have been so low
that they
said
you don't qualify.
You should have been paying higher fees.
We should have been paying the higher fees, the higher rates, so you could build a reserve, and then they would match whatever was generated, and then they would give us money, or we could borrow money.
Because with raising the rates the way we're raising now, and Kip just said it's $176,000 more. Well, $176,000 into $30 million is going to take a long time to generate that.
Exactly.
That's right. But by raising the rates and showing that we're making, you know, our rates are more equitable instead of being, I mean, we're truly at the bottom of the rates in the whole Commonwealth. And so what we need to do is, our intention is not to go to the top. Our intention is just to nudge higher from the bottom so we're, you know, closer to the average. And then we're eligible for loans.
How do we compare to a community like Hadley? I mean, I know they're more or less the same size we are.
Amherst was closer to the average, state average. That's how come I...
Yeah, but I think there was some...
They have like UMass and...
Right, they have a lot of...
A bunch of big institutions, but I think Hadley, you know, they have more commercial shops and stuff than we do, but I think population-wise, they're about the same. I'm not sure
their
infrastructure size is the same as ours, but I was just curious on what they charge. I was going to do some homework, but
No, it's helpful. And if you come to the sewer study, you know, committee meetings too, they're, as they discuss, we're learning a lot. And I think they're, you know, they are reaching out and checking Hatfield and different areas and what they're doing and how they're doing it. And Orange, I know, has a similar plant. A lot of these plants came in when the EPA came into existence, built a lot of these things. And I know that they've had to go through a big replacement.
It'd just be helpful for the people
to know.
We compare to a town we got away for a long time with not paying a lot of money.
Yep.
Instead of being, we're getting charged five times more than what we paid before.
Right.
There are certain requirements that we need to meet, I think, from just about a year from now. And if we don't, then we can get fined from the state. I personally don't understand the fine process. I don't know if they actually send a fine to the town or if they just withhold money. I'm not sure how the process works, but I do know that come January 1, 2018, if we don't do some of these things, that we'll be fined. So,
what he's talking about is similar to the infiltration, you know, having to meet the infiltration requirements or, you know, and pull the people's sub pumps out of the sewer system. You know, we had to do that kind of stuff. We were under a mandate. So it was similar. We have not, we talked about it a little bit a couple weeks ago, but if truly there's hardships, if people have filed paperwork with there's two different abatement, property tax abatement systems that the assessors use. And if people have filed paperwork with the assessors for property tax abatements, it would be not necessary in my mind. I mean, this is just my opinion, but it would be not necessarily for them to refile the paperwork with us to qualify for an abatement. So if you're going through the property tax abatement process through the assessors, certainly, you know, confidentially, we would certainly work with the same abatement system. If there are there truly hardships, we need people to come forward to us and, you know, talk to us so that we know, you know, that we can help. Because it is not our intention to make people choose between medicine and paying their sewer bills and stuff like that. So, I mean, that's just my personal feeling. Mm-hmm. But I think we feel very strongly about that. So. We haven't talked about that very much, but I do want people to realize that we're certainly sympathetic. So if there's no more discussion, then have a good night.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
And thank you for coming out. And all I can say is please stay involved because this is a voluntary board. We are now voluntarily running the town at the moment, too, since we have no staff. So we could use all the help we can.
Absolutely.
To keep control of stuff. So anyway, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
And pretty much, oh, Trevor, the only item that we didn't get to finish to discuss, did you ever find out we got that grant for the $45,000 grant?
Oh, yes.
Are we going to really use it?
Well, I spoke to Doug today, and I asked him if he would educate me a bit on what he's doing, get a couple of people together, either from, you know, IT from the school or John, who's been in their office, to just get a group together probably next Friday.
Okay.
Just kind of Doug Finn, because he had applied for it, and he knew kind of why he applied, what he was thinking. I just wanted to pick his brain, like,
well, we're not sure if we're really going to use it.
Yeah, we may not even find, like, it was worth it.
And if we don't use it, I have another grant that I want to write.
Is this for the
district?
Yeah, so, and that's, yeah.
It's hard to get that start up. Come on, Kevin. Remember.
Give her a hard time about spending money on shopping mosquitoes.
No. Now, you're getting nuisance mosquitoes just mixed up with disease mosquitoes. Oh, come on. If you give your horse triple
digestion. And you voted this?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep. We're all set.
Great.
Okay.
Great.
So I think that's it.
Sounds good.
Right.
And this is something John put together.
Yeah, John was just showing how much
different properties.
Yeah.
And this was
looking for.
We're good. Yeah, we'll make a motion to adjourn.
Just one more question. Upcoming events.
Oh,
so you have a town administrator reception? Do you have somebody in mind, or is this just to meet all the candidates?
We're going to meet all the candidates.
Okay.
We're not really sure. We haven't figured out. We're going to have the presentation of the town administrator candidates, and then we'll decide at that point how we want to proceed.
It made it sound like you already had somebody.
Oh no!
This is public. Please come in.
That's what it sounds like.
We're going to interview the.
There's four.
Four people.
Okay. Four people that are sort of the same, and so we're going to interview all four of them and see what chemistry happens and how we want to move forward as a board. Because the problem is we don't have any staff, so all discussion. So we don't break the open meeting law. All discussion has to be in public,
right.
and so we. I mean, there's no way to have a conduit of any let's do this, let's do that, let's do this.
We can't talk to each other.
We can't talk to each other. So it's we have to decide next week how we want to move forward.
Okay.
Based on how we feel about the candidates. Do we want to have one more night of, say we whittle it down to two?
Yes.
Do we want to have...
We kind of did. But we're done.
Oh, Kathy had just one question.
Yeah, she had one question.
I wasn't sure if I was supposed to be putting this on TV.
No. We're just asking. She just wanted to know.
So you're still going?
No, we're done.
Yeah,
it doesn't matter.
Make a motion to adjourn.
Is that the vote?
Yes.
Yes.
We're done.
Yeah.
We're done.
Thank you.